More foreign nationals have been extracted from conflict-torn Sudan. On Monday, two Italian military planes evacuated 96 people out of the country. South Korea was also able to rescue 28 individuals in a military aircraft. Meanwhile, a Saudi ship carrying nearly 200 people evacuated from the country arrived in Jeddah. The United Nations doubles down on its call for a peaceful resolution to the political crisis in Sudan.
The violence must stop. It risks a catastrophic conflagration within Sudan that could engulf the whole region and beyond. I strongly condemn the indiscriminate bombardment of civilian areas, including healthcare facilities. And I call on the parties to stop combat operations in densely populated areas and to allow unhindered humanitarian aid operations.
Warring military leaders in Sudan agree to a 72-hour ceasefire as the country's face race to rescue their citizens from the crisis-hit country. U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken says the truce will begin Tuesday. He adds Washington is exploring options to return a diplomatic consular presence to the country as soon as possible.
Now, keep in mind as well that the overwhelming majority of American citizens in Sudan are dual nationals who have made their lives there, been living there for years, for decades, for generations. And many want to continue to do that. But for those who are seeking to leave, we'll continue to engage directly with them to see what we can do to help them. And as I said, with allies and partners as well, help facilitate their departure.
Doubts remain on whether or not the Sudan Armed Forces and the paramilitary group RSF will abide by the agreement, as the two sides failed to follow several previous truce deals. The fighting, which erupted more than a week ago, has left more than 420 people dead and thousands hurt. Filipinos in Sudan continue to fear for their safety. A Filipino worker says there are no more safe areas left in Sudan's capital, Khartoum. This as looting became rampant. Most telecommunication services are also down. They have been calling on the Philippine government to rescue them, but were only asked to submit documents.
Parang hindi po inasikaso yung mga Pilipino dito. Pati po yung consul dito, hindi po kumikilos. Kami na lang po mga Pilipino na nandito sa Khartoum. Sobra na nga po ang takot namin dahil sunod-sunod na po ang putukan dito. Umaga pa lang po hanggang hapon.
But the Foreign Affairs Department recently gave assurance help is on the way. A land repatriation is also being arranged to rescue affected Filipinos.
Khartoum, dadalhin sila by bus to the border town between Sudan and Egypt. And from there, dadalhin sa Aswan, which is a tourist town in Egypt. May flights doon. So this week, possibly within the next 24 hours, meron na tayong umpisang marirepatriate. Unti-unti, nag-aagawan kasi tayo with other countries, competition for the available bus. And hindi basta-basta magsasakay, kailangan may escort o may tao from the consulate.
President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. asserts it's time for Manila to update its security deals with Washington. He points to growing tensions in the Asia-Pacific region that may already require this. The president made the remark Monday during an interview on the radio program of his former Social Welfare Secretary Erwin Tulfo. Marcos says he will discuss that when he meets U.S. President Biden at the White House next week. He adds he and Biden may tackle the U.S.-Philippine Mutual Defense Agreement and the Visiting Forces Agreement, which Manila renewed with Washington in 2021.
It has to evolve. Dahil nag-evolve din. Kailangan ina-adjust din natin yan. Dahil meron din talagang evolution. May nagbabago rin sa sitwasyon na hinaharap natin dito sa South China Sea, sa gitna ng mga pangyayari, sa Taiwan, sa North Korea, lahat ito mga ano na medyo umiinit ang sitwasyon dito sa atin.
Before meeting President Marcos, U.S. President Joe Biden will host his South Korean counterpart at the White House Wednesday. As this report tells us, the allies face unprecedented challenges.
In some ways, it looks like the same old story. North Korea conducts a provocation, such as this missile launch earlier this month. In response, the U.S. and South Korea hold big displays of military strength, such as these drills on a U.S. aircraft carrier. Here in Seoul, some version of this has happened for 7 decades, which is how long the U.S. and South Korea have been allies. But as both sides celebrate their alliance this week at the White House, several issues of trust have emerged. Perhaps the biggest is whether South Koreans can trust the U.S. to defend their country. With North Korea now able to threaten the U.S. mainland, many question if Washington would intervene in a conflict. The question is so urgent that President Yoon Suk-yeol has even suggested South Korea could develop its own nuclear weapons if its security concerns are not addressed. To reassure South Koreans, Washington has sent its most powerful military assets for highly visible drills. But Seoul wants more, says analyst Jenny Town.
Is it enough? You know, is it ever really enough? And I'm sure, you know, as North Korea continues to focus on especially ICBM development, you know, I think these demands will continue to grow, even if there is an appreciation for how much more the U.S. has been putting into this.
Another source of tension is South Korea's reluctance to arm Ukraine. Although South Korea has become a major weapons exporter, it says it cannot arm Ukraine directly because of domestic laws. Instead, South Korea has helped indirectly by approving the sale of weapons like these tanks to countries such as Poland that are arming Ukraine. U.S.-South Korea tensions over Ukraine were exposed by the recent leak of U.S. documents, which suggested Washington spied on senior South Korean officials. Seoul has downplayed the incident. But many Koreans remain upset, says scholar Park Won-gon.
Because South Korea and United States, we are allies, and then the leaking information is nothing new. Everybody knows. If the United States really interested in this issue, just give a phone call to our officials, and then South Korean people can be happy to answer all those processes.
For Yoon, perhaps the biggest challenge is a low approval rating at home. Analysts say that may give him limited foreign policy flexibility, as he attempts to align his country more closely with the West. But in Washington, Yoon hopes to encounter a friendlier audience as he celebrates 7 decades of an alliance that is broadly popular in both countries. Bill Gallo, VOA News, Seoul, South Korea.
United Nations Chief Antonio Guterres not mincing words as he denounced Russia's invasion of Ukraine in front of Moscow's foreign minister. Sergei Lavrov was chairing a Security Council meeting as Russia holds the monthly rotating presidency of the UN for April. There, the Secretary General told Lavrov that Moscow was adding to the global economic woes brought by the pandemic.
Russia's invasion of Ukraine, in violation of the United Nations Charter and international law, is causing massive suffering and devastation to the country and its people, and adding to the global economic dislocation triggered by the COVID-19 pandemic.
Britain's Prime Minister Rishi Sunak believes governments have a crucial role in the safe use of artificial intelligence. According to Sunak, governments need sovereign capability over AI to manage risks to national security. Britain announced £100 million in initial funding for a task force to help develop foundation models, a type of AI used by chatbots like ChatGPT for use in fields like healthcare and education.
We talk to not just business, but the defense community as well to make sure the UK is well positioned, not just to capitalize on the opportunities that we all are aware of, but also to protect ourselves against the risks that the technology might pose.